right? Blues is a freed black person's music. It is not a slave music. It is a response to something. It is a response to the terrain. Hip hop is a freed black person slash Latino person music. And I would say some people might get upset, but there were Jewish males and females part of the culture still to this day, right? But these things started from lack of resource or the response to societal shifts. The expression morphed, right?
And I didn't think the list would be complete without this, because I didn't think the story of the Temptations is complete without this, but I included Al. I included Elbridge.
I'm happy you did, because going right to D.
He's going right to D.
It's a useful term as your scientific knowledge, your traditional knowledge. Mm-hmm. It's not a dichotomy, though, because all science is ethno-science.
Yeah.
All knowledge is traditional knowledge. So it's kind of wishy-washy in a way. And honestly, I don't like a lot of the scholarship that this is shady. I don't love a lot of the scholarship that emerges of it, because it's not seeing knowledge as a complex dynamic process that changes over time. A lot of the stuff I've read is like, this is traditional ecological knowledge. One, you know, when the birds do this, the weather is going to do this. Two, when the lake ice comes off here, the spawning season will be this. Like, okay, these are tidbits, but this is not how knowledge works. Mm-hmm. It's like saying that a list of facts is the same thing as knowledge. But knowledge is always negotiated. It's always changing. It's in dialogue with itself in really complex ways. And I would love to see scholars who work with traditional ecological knowledge recognize that it's not a corpus of knowledge in the past that's being eroded, which does have some legitimacy, because knowledge loss and cultural loss is a thing, and we have to recognize it as a thing. But knowledge is always, it's protean. It's always changing and evolving and mutating in complex, sometimes tragic, sometimes beautiful ways.
How's that work, Daisy?
Great tape. Thanks. Maybe she can climb?
Can she? No, I don't think she climbs. I mean, she can go this way.
Oh.
Get the ladders. Ladders and chat.
Ladders and chat, everyone. I've got a climb to make.
I know. Where are the ladders? But I mean, part of it too is really, really interesting is sort of the idea of contemporary collecting, of collecting now in the moment while things are happening.
Yeah.
I've talked quite a bit with people about, like, there's things even now in the pandemic that are normalized for us that were really not normal early in the pandemic. Like, for instance, limited menus or getting your groceries, you know, picked up, or, you know, well, wearing masks, you know, things like that. So, it was really important to me that we start collecting oral histories as soon as possible, because I knew that there were going to be things that we were just going to sort of, you know, our memories sort of collapse and lose a lot of the nuance. I think that's sort of similar to what Kate Horgan talked about in her book on her King Katrina narratives, yeah. Right? Of like, we sort of fit our experience then into like what we expect people to say about it, and, you know, or what we think people expect us to say, and so it loses a lot of the nuance. So, sorry, dog and cat fight.
There's very powerful energy happening back there.
Yeah, powerful aura. Powerful aura in the background. Oh, yeah, sit like that so we can see. Sit like that so we can see. So we've met Louise, and then who are they back there?
So that's Dave as the cat on the dog, on the crate, and... Harry's the dog.
Are they okay?
They do this every day.
Oh my goodness. Okay. the chaotic familiars as Death Loris.
I love the Dave noise.
Oh my goodness.
Okay. Harry, no. I'm in an interview.
Harry, please. Oh my God.
All right, and we're going to go. This is going to be another episode of Folkwise Live Reacts. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Folkwise Live Reacts. And we are going to watch Jin.
This is hilarious.
Jump like a horse. Jin. Now, this is a thing on Instagram.
This is a real thing. This isn't just a thing that we just created. This is a real community.
This is a real thing. This is a community of girls who jump like horses. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
You, and I know it's complicated, but I hate being smart. So all the things that you do makes me a sucker. All
oh right, my God. So is this
it's
the
such good... So I guess good energy.
I guess my question is this the ultimate form of horse girl? And if not, what will horse girls eventually become if not this?
Yeah, we need to know.
I mean, that's pretty ultimate because honestly, I think what's beautiful about that is like there's ways of jumping that are not like a horse, right? And they are definitely jumping like a horse. Like they
exactly.
This is definitely horse behavior. So we had another question, and I believe this is from Sarlasso. And she says, how much were you able to predict slash expect the way information moved during the pandemic based on your previous research?
Oh, that's good. A lot. Like, there were definitely themes. I didn't know necessarily the specifics, but I knew the themes. Like, I knew that a trend towards, you know, this thing in your house.
This,
but I
this
didn't
thing in your house
know.
Could have COVID, you said?
Yeah. So that there would be a household object. But I didn't know exactly what it was going to be. So mm-hmm. It was like, so like the specifics, the little variations.
Right.
But the big, like the big picture, I was pretty accurate.
Everything. All right, are we good to go here?
Oh my God.
Okay. Okay, I'm sitting here with fabulous folklorist Andrea Keita.
This is so funny.
Andrea, introduce yourself to us and tell us how you became a folklorist.
Well, Dr. McNeil. it's hard to keep a straight
face.
Okay,
go.
I'm going.
This table is wet.
Oh, why is the table wet?
Dom is sweating.
That was Dom. Dom made the table wet.
Just sweating on
the... My beer.
Oh, okay. Okay, that's more acceptable. Okay, so I became a folklorist. There's a lot of reasons. I think one of them, though, is our shared love of Ghostbusters.
It's true.
We should talk about that.
We should.
It is also because I watched Poltergeist like 50 billion times as a small child. And I was a history major, and I liked the parts of history that nobody else liked. And I was like, what about all the other people? And that's part of it, too.
Well done.
Yeah.
What about all the other
what
people?
What about all the other people?
That's our entire discipline.
What about all the other people?
Yep.
Hashtag folklore.
Yeah, we're going to put it on a t-shirt.
Yeah.
I think also we're extension cords. Like, we are not providing the power, we're providing the space between.
Now that I love. I love
that's
being
cool.
An extension
yeah,
cord.
Extension cord. Yeah. Yeah.
I think the best
the networker, can... the bringing people together, the connecting the communities across communities.
I was
like,
say, connect
you
the
know.
Community to the money.
Yeah, I mean, that also, absolutely.
I'll give a really good example. So, like, I used to work at Tucson Meet Yourself, and one of the things, I was a stage manager, and I would introduce ensembles if there wasn't. My job is not to go up and perform Japanese traditional dance with Mari Kaneta and the Suzuyuki Kai. My goal is to introduce them to the audience and get the hell out of the way. And then, of course, be like, hey, do you have, like, 5 more minutes? That's what we do. And I think we get really passionate about the stuff, but we have to get, like, publicly passionate about it. And that's not... And some people are more the type, like, I want to research this and I want somebody else to be that person. And that is completely okay because we don't have to be everything. Like, I've worked as a nonprofit director, but I didn't do everything. I hired a case manager for a job. And I think with museums, it's the same way. You have to be a hype person of your own department. But you can work with others to make that happen. And I think that's where we start kind of pulling our resources together.
Now this
playing
next
with
one,
my cat while I'm talking to you.
I was going to say, this next one just says show cats.
I will say it weird. Said show weird. Cats in all caps.
I don't
and
know
then
if that's a question. It might be a well, command.
A demand.
Yeah. I added in the middle of it based on the first question that was asked by a chatter in the chat, Deathlorist, mm-hmm. which was yet to be addressed. As an orange cat owner, do you know about the jorts panel at AFS this year?
Hi, guys.
Look at them.
What's up,
they're
dudes?
They're jorts. Jorts one, jorts two. Oh, my gosh.
This is Phoenix.
Phoenix?
Her full name is Phoenix Sky Harbor.
Aw.
Nice.
And then the other one who's more social, he's Cinder. He's Cinderblock Bookshelf.
I love it. Cinderblock Bookshelf.
Oh my god, I love that. I love that so much. Cinderblock Bookshelf.
We have the what That's the kids like name door. The cats.
Yeah.
So the what the kids name the cats, Cinder and Phoenix, versus what the adults name them.
Love it.
Sure.
Wow. As a public folklorist, you learn how to get good at writing for the public and figuring out your audience. So that worked really nicely. I think I don't suck at social media because I know what people will generally think is funny, I think, unless you read my Twitter, which in retrospect, some of it's funny. Some of those replies. Some of those replies. I know jokes. I know the emojis. But like the thing is, at nonprofits or any small arts kind of organization or cultural organization, like just being able to like actually fluently use the internet is a really big asset. People like the directors don't have time to even worry about it. My phone is just like, ooh, oh God, Sydney's watching. Hi, Sydney. Sydney says I know jokes. So like just being a millennial who was like extremely online worked to my advantage for sure. The website is an outlier. The website is not I don't do any web anything anymore, like ever. And I'm amazed that I made that happen. But that was a product
pretty,
of
it looks pretty
the...
good. You did good.
Thanks.
That's awesome.
It's really clunky, but that was the product of my informatics minor. That was the one thing that, like, you know, I could actually figure out because of that. I can't believe I did that. I'm pretty proud
That's
of me.
That's awesome. What's like one, if I could be that narrow, thing, like concern that you might have as a folklorist doing participant observation at a protest?
Ooh, dying?
Oh my god. I mean, yeah, I guess.
If I can hop in with a comment from chat, GB Davis Folk Art says mom didn't like that answer.
I know she didn't. I'm sorry, Mom. I also know Mom's really proud of me because Mama taught me how to protest. She's done her time. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Joel, something that you talk about a lot when you talk about folklore is listening. So we were curious how listening is essential to folklore methodology for you.
Oh, it's everything. And I think it's the greatest skill that I... I'm always striving to develop further. And, you know, this is something that, you know, I definitely learned at IU, but I don't think it got knocked through my skull until I came through WKU that, you know, an interview is not necessarily a conversation. And if you want to, I don't know, if you want to be a good folklorist in a lot of times, a lot of context, you need to just shut up and be there. And listen. And, you know, it took a lot of me listening back to interviews where I'm not necessarily interrupting the question. I may be saying something as simple as that, you know, and I'm like, damn, shut the hell up and just let them talk. And anyways, so, listening is kind of at the core, especially as someone who's not a Kentucky native. I'm not from far away, so I get a lot of the same things, but, you know, I had a lot to learn. When you want to get into that deeper community connection into the, you know, the people you're working with, your friends, I think listening is you know, step one, and you know, the core of kind of my personal folklore philosophy.
Look, can I say one more thing?
Yeah.
I just want to say, and I told Daisy this earlier, but my absolute favorite thing of Folkwise is when you guys are talking to people and they say something really interesting, profound. It's really great. And Daisy goes, "What?"
That's such a good impression of them.
What?
What?
It's literally my favorite part of Daisy and the show.